How are you doing? You all right? I'm good, Ty. Yeah, thanks for asking. So today, it's the third and final part of the Target Note series. If I ever hear the phrase Target Note again, probably just gonna slice my own little ears off, hang them on the wall. But hopefully you're not too tired of it, because today I'm gonna show you two more intervals that we're gonna add in, the perfect fifth and the minor seven. Have fun. So as I mentioned in part two, a dominant seventh chord has four notes in it. We have a root note, a major third, a perfect fifth, and a minor seven or a flat seven. How rude! Sophie Burrell interrupting my YouTube video. I didn't want to make a part four. Everyone knows trilogies are the best. So I thought I would squeeze the five and the seven into one lesson. If you want to take a deeper dive into all of this, you can grab the tabs and the backing tracks for the three-part series, all highlighted and annotated on my Patreon. In she comes. You can resolve your phrases on these notes. You can pass through them, but I just think they'll just make you better, like me. And that's it, really. That's why you're here, isn't it? Let's be honest. First of all, let's find out where the five and the seven are within each of the chords. So if you've ever played a power chord and you've seen it written out as A5, for example, that's because we've got our root note and the fifth note of the scale on top of it. So that's our five right there. Our flat seven or our minor seven is here on the fifth fret of the D string, the note G. And if you wanted to find that in the second octave, eighth fret of the B string. For the D7, again, our perfect fifth is really easy to find, the note A. And obviously for the second octave, it's our root note of the scale, the A right at the top. The minor seven interval in the D7 chord is the fifth fret of the G string. And that's the note C. We can also use the 8th fret of the high E string. Obviously, as you know from the other lessons, when we move the D7 chord up to the E7, our intervals are found in the same place within that chord. So our perfect fifth is the 9th fret of the D, the note B, and our minor 7 interval is the 7th fret of the G, the note D. And as I've said before, it's really important to then take those intervals and figure out where they fall within your first shape. So you get comfortable there and then go on to the other shapes and move it around. So our perfect fifth, which is the note B, we can play here, 7th fret of the high E string, or we could even maybe play it on the 4th fret of the G. Both of those are the note B. And obviously the minor seven interval is a D, and we've learned that as a root note of one of the chords. So you should be able to find your way around with that already. So just to recap, for an A7, you've got an E and a G for your fifth and your minor seven. For a D7, you've got an A and a C for your fifth and your minor seven. And for an E7, you've got a B and a D for your fifth and your minor seven. So I'm going to show you two licks that actually play back to back in the example. I think it's bar three and four, which go to the fifth and then the seven. So it's quite cool to learn them back to back. And they're quite Jimmy Page-esque, I think, if I do say so myself. But the first one goes like this. And the second one goes like this. So in the rhythm section here, bar three, we've still got an A7. And this little lick starts with a pre-bend on the seventh fret of the G, whole step down, and we pull off to the five. Go back to the seven, and then pick the five on the B. It's quite a quick little lick. We go back to the seven on the G, and then the five, down to the seven on the D, back to the five on the G, and then the seven on the G. Now, instead of just leaving that note of D at the end, we bend that up and add some vibrato. It goes up a whole step to E, which is the fifth of A7. And I like to kind of bring my picking hand in halfway through that bend before it gets too wild and loses its pitch. I sort of bring the right hand in to choke it. So it just kind of softly fades it out. For me, the perfect fifth is a cool sounding note to resolve a phrase on, but it doesn't kind of feel conclusive like it's the end, which is what you get from the root. This is just my opinion. This is what I do. I attach a vibe, motion or feeling to a note, and then I go to it when I want that. So if I want something that sounds cool, but I don't want it to kind of feel like it's teetering off at the end, I go to the fifth. Straight after that, we then play this little lick. So we have a little flick into a blues note, a quick bend up to the major third, and then it slides down from the root to the seven. So there's a lot going on there. If you start on the seventh fret of the G, we're going to quickly slide up to the eighth fret and then back. Then I pull off to the fifth fret of the G. It's a really quick little movement, that, so just go slow with it at first. Make sure they're all evenly spaced. I then bring my third finger back down to the seven, pick that note. Then I play the fifth fret of the G, but I bend that up the semitone, half step, so that we push the minor third into the major third. Then I hit the seventh fret of the D, which is the note A, and I slide down to the minor seven, the note G, for the first time. So it goes like this. I think it's important that you let notes sound out for a second. You hold them before adding vibrato, because vibrato on a guitar is only ever taking the pitch sharp and back down to center, sharp and back down to center. And even if you go, you know, you bend it up, back down to middle, you bend the string down, it's not bending it lower, it's going higher pitch, higher pitch, higher pitch. So it's really important that you focus on that tonal center. And you come back to it so that, you know, I guess the listener is aware of what note you've hit, rather than just something like that. You've completely moved away from the core note. Something that I've worked on a lot over the years. I really hated my vibrato, it was too spiky and unpredictable. And it takes time and a lot of work to make it something musical. So if you go into a note now, I've tried to lay off going for vibrato straight away, and I sort of bring it in and I keep it really controlled. But if I want it wild, I make it wild. I'm just going to show you a lick that goes over a different chord. It's a bar of D7 towards the end of the 12th bar, and it ends again on the minor 7, and it really sets up the next lick, which is A7, quite nicely. We start with a slide into the 7th fret of the G, the note D, so our root note. Then we go index finger on the 5th fret of the B, and then the 3rd finger on the 7. So that's our major 3rd in the key of D. We do a little semitone push up, and then down, we release. Back to the index finger. Then we go to the 3rd finger on the 7th fret of the G again, the root note. And then our index finger goes back to that minor 7, which is the note C, 5th fret of the G. And that is the time and the place for some wild vibrato straight away, because it's staccato and I wanted it fairly raucous, if that makes sense. So then we slide into the 7th fret of the D, the note A. Index finger on the G, and then back to 7th fret of the D. And over the top of the D7 chord, that is the perfect 5th, the note A, we were talking about that before. But the next chord is A7, and I go to a palm muted A in the bass. So you've kind of set yourself up nicely. You've resolved right at the end to the 5th of D, but then the next bar starts with A. And you can go into your next lick. Here's the first two again, which were over A7. And then the last two over D7. Thanks for watching this series. If you're new here, make sure you hit subscribe, thumb up the video, leave me a comment, suggestion, question. Promise I'll get back to you. Don't forget you can grab the tabs with notes and the backing tracks for parts 1, 2, and 3 over on my Patreon. Make sure that you go over everything that we covered and you understand it for what it is, rather than just learning 3 solos of increasing technical ability, because they were written as examples and they're good examples, but the idea is that you understand the concept and you play and write things way better than that. They're just there to teach. And like I said, if you do fully understand it and you're aware of what chords are playing in the background and what notes are going to sound good over those chords, if you go on YouTube or you get a CD with a load of mixed backing tracks on and you flick through the chord progression, you're like, okay, this is what's going on. You know what it's going to sound like. No surprises, no horrible duff notes like I used to hit when I was 12 and thinking, what is that? What the hell was that? And like I said, in the first video, that was me when I was younger, and it was the inspiration for me to make this little series. So I genuinely hope you've learned something, you've had fun, and you'll hit that subscribe button and you'll come back real soon, and I promise we'll do something really fun. Take it easy. I'll see you soon.